So topic for the day is role of armed forces in nation building. Now in this presentation, I have used this word army number of times. And when I say army, it means the armed forces. Army, Navy, Air Force, and all affiliated arms of the armed forces. So do not go by only it is army. Now when we are talking about nation building, we must understand what is a nation. There is a definition of a nation. Desh kya hota hai? There is a definition of that. So if you look at it, a nation state is defined territory with a sovereign government and made up of people sharing common culture, history and languages. That means it has to have a common culture, it has to have common history and common language. That's where you have a nation. Look at Europe. You have France. Now France has got unique history, it has one language and they have their own culture. Similarly, UK is totally different from there. Germany is totally different. So these are all nation states. So this definition is primarily a European definition, and this is how we describe it. Now, when we correlate it with India, in India we have different geographical regions where different ethno-racial groups are localized. So from a sociological perspective, India is far from being a nation state. Now it's a very loaded statement I have given. But we always say that unity in diversity. So basically what is happening within India, India is a democratic republic constituted as a union of states, which is given our constitution, and it is a politically sovereign state. Therefore, the national integration is more difficult in case of India. So when we are talking of Europe, France, Germany, these are very homogeneous entities. As far as India is concerned, it is very difficult. When we call India as a nation, it is very difficult to govern and it is very difficult to integrate. Fine? Okay. What is the construct of nation building? We have understood what is a nation. Now say, what is nation building? Since my topic is role of armed forces in nation building, so let us understand what is nation building as such. Firstly, we must define what we are talking about. What does nation building imply? Originally, nation building referred to the efforts of newly independent nations, notably the nations of Asia and Africa. We had number of colonies, European colonies in Africa and Asia and all these countries. When they got independence, that's the time all these economies are very nascent economies. They're very poor. They did not have any infrastructure. They did not have industry. So when you say nation building, primarily raising these nations from scratch to a level where they can survive as a nation state. This was needed to be deliberately constructed by molding different ethnic groups into a nation, especially since in many newly established states, the colonial practices of divide and rule had resulted in ethnically heterogeneous populations. If you look at West Asia, Iran, Iraq, Syria, and all these countries, when you look at it, they do not have the natural boundaries. These boundaries were created by the Britishers. And they were not based on ethnicity or their culture or their language. That is the reason what you find in West Asia, what is happening today in Syria and Saudi Arabia, in Iran and Yemen, all these areas is primarily because of that. The 21st century looks towards security, that is number one, justice and economic development. These are three main issues that any government is looking at. So these are the pillars of nation building are secured, and these are three, that is security, justice, economy, these are pillars of nation building. And to do that, what is there underlined? Security comes first in the pecking order, because the other three pillars function effectively only if the security threshold of the nation both internal and external, remain intact. A country cannot progress unless its external forces are under check and internally there is a calm and peace and tranquility. And for that, it is a security mechanism which is required. Unfortunately, in states where the roots of democracy are not firmly embedded, security becomes a victim of inefficient, parochial and dithering attitude that form the essence of difficult business that defines democracy. In turn, it opens a window of opportunity for the armed forces to take over the reins of governance. Look around India, look at Pakistan, look at Bangladesh, look at down south, you'll find the armed forces have got a say into the governance, and especially Pakistan. So therefore, nation building, what is the definition? Nation building is a process of structuring national identity and maintaining it using the power of the state. In consequence, the national integrity of a state is an essential element for its survival in the face of political, economic, social, ethnic and religious differentials induced from within or external influences. Therefore, the scope of nation building has national security as an important factor as it sanitizes the environment to facilitate other institutions of governance to function to their optimum potential. Accordingly, the structures of an emerging nation state are built around the central spine provided by the military. That means all these newly independent states, I'm talking of 40s and 50s in Asia and Africa, for growth of those countries, the central spine, the basic bedrock of growth had to depend on military. Let us see environmental scan. Former British territories all around us. All of you know Pakistan and earlier East Pakistan. It was army directed democracy. Frequent army rule. Look at Bangladesh. There is a democracy there, but initially, soon after this, when this country was created by us, that's the time the military, Ziaur Rahman, he was literally a dictator, and till date, the army has a lot of influence over the governance. Nepal and Bhutan, these are monarchies, and monarchs always work through the army. Sri Lanka, there is a democracy, but it suffers from ethnic exclusivity towards the Sinhala groups. That means there is a divide between Sinhalas, who are in majority, Tamils and other ethnic groups are subservient. Similarly, Maldives, you must be reading in newspapers what is happening in Maldives. There are a lot of political turmoil as of date. Afghanistan, they had a monarchy, then they turned to communist, then they have become, they are in a democracy. But politically, it is the most volatile country as of now. There is sectarian and tribal divide in Afghanistan. Myanmar had military junta. Now in this entire, it is the same area, same region. It is only India. It is the largest democracy of the world, of the people, by the people, for the people. This is the only island of true democracy in this complete region and the entire world. So it goes to the founding fathers of our nation who had made constitution, and all our political leaders, our army leadership, which had ensured that democracy stays, and it is a very, very vibrant democracy. I've already discussed this. Indian Army has proven to be one of the strongest pillars of our national power, never ever failing in delivering whatever task has been assigned to it by the national polity, military or non-military. This is, all of you know it, whenever army has been given any assignment by the government, it has always delivered and delivered it very well. I'll be discussing it as we go by this presentation. While doing above, it has also contributed towards steering the nation from a humble beginning to acquiring stature of a leading world economy. As on date, we are on the threshold of third largest economy of the world. And our GDP growth is second highest after China, and it is likely to take over in the next 4 to 5 years, even China also. The nation building, the foundation, how is there? Environmental realities at the time of independence, how we were in 1947. Number one, nation was divided on, it was divided on religious line in three parts. India, Pakistan and West Pakistan and East Pakistan. Then, largest migration of the population, the history of the world witnessed unparalleled violence. It was the company means lakhs and lakhs people moved from India to Pakistan and from Pakistan to India. Law and order mechanism was totally ineffective. National institutions and resources were divided between India and Pakistan. Army divided into two parts, Pak Army and Indian Army. One third of army had gone there. All the Muslim soldiers there joined Pakistan, wherein the remainder of army continued to be the same. The social fabric of an ancient civilization was torn apart, and with its value system cherished for centuries was under threat. Because this country was divided on theocratic lines, that means on a religion, base of religion a country was created, which was unnatural. When you correlate it with the definition of a nation state, it should have a culture, it should have a language, alright? And it should have a same ethnicity. In the neighboring country, none of these are there. They have Indian culture. Alright? Ethnically, they're Indian. Okay? Language-wise, is half Indian, half mix of all other Western Asian countries. So there is nothing natural about nationhood. I always call it, Pakistan is a sub-nationality of Indian nationality as such. And that is a fact, which they do not want to agree. The foundation of nation building, how we went about it. Jammu and Kashmir wanted to remain independent and Pakistan attempted to seize J&K by force in 1947. J&K ceded with India on 26 October 1947 as per the norms laid down by the princely states, and there was a rule called India Independence Act 1947. In that, all the princes, rajas and maharajas who had semi-independent kind of territories, they could cede either with Pakistan or India. But J&K had not ceded till that time. 26 October, prior to that, Pakistan had started sending the raiders into Kashmir to take over, and they were just short of Srinagar airport. And that's the time the Maharaja Hari Singh, he signed the instrument of accession. And that's the time first Sikh of Indian Army, they were airlifted, they landed at Srinagar airport, and thereafter all these raiders were stopped, and then they were pushed back into where they are as on day. Now, how it matters, the last bullet if you read, the first taste of violation of national integrity by an external force. This is the first time in independent India, someone outsider, that is Pakistan, had violated our territorial integrity. It was a very big question mark, it had to be corrected. Now, liberation of Goa, Daman, Diu on 18th and 19th December 1961, it was the first trial service operation launched by the armed forces. So these were merged into India, courtesy armed forces. Now, what are pillars of democracy? Legislature, executive, judiciary. And all these three in a democracy can only function when you have armed forces which provide them stability from the external aggression, and whenever it is required to help out the central police forces and police and other internal security mechanisms in time of crisis. Like in J&K and Northeast. The area, a lot of trouble is there, a lot of internal problems are there. So army is helping out the civilian government in these areas. So army is the stabilizing factor to take care that legislature, executive and judiciary, they function well and they function effectively. The consolidation, after initial 47, right up to 53, 54, That was a time, it was a time of turbulence. Then gradually the country started stabilizing. The birth of a republic, constitutional interface, that we envisage balance of power among the national institutions of governance. Role of army in the democratic system. What is the role of army? Sanitize the external and assist to stabilize the internal environment for smooth conduct of governance. What I discussed in the previous slide. Now, transformation ambiguities. Army was earlier the British Army, and British Army was basically for area control. They wanted to control the population here. And now our requirement was different. We had to look towards Pakistan, and we had to look towards China or any other inimical forces which are trying to disturb India. So we had to transform this army from a colonial army to a nationalist army. And the third bullet, what you see, is very important. A political conduct of armed forces facilitated laying down structure of economic growth in a politically stable environment. Very important part. This is part which was ignored by Pakistan. If you look at down below in red, Pakistani army chose to undermine the democratic jurisdiction of the elected government in a similar circumstances. They have yet to decide what kind of political system they want. It's still an unstabilized country. Half of the time it is the army which has ruled that country. And Pakistan has multiple power centers. They have no balance in national institution or governance, despite three constitutions. And I will use the word fire and forget type of constitution. They make a constitution, next ruler comes in, he throws out that, all right, and then next constitution comes. Now the new government is coming in, I wonder if they are going to bring in a fourth constitution. And lastly, Pakistan continues to be politically unstable, economically very weak, and strategically vulnerable. Economy-wise, Pakistan as on date has got money worth to run that country only for 3 months. They need a bailout from outside world. And they're strategically very, very vulnerable. All if you know that China is sitting inside Pakistan as on date, with China-Pak economic corridor, Chinese people are there, and it is a matter of time Pakistan will be converted into a Chinese colony. So their sovereignty itself is under threat. So they are very, very vulnerable. And look at their vulnerability. In 1980s, when Russians came to Afghanistan, Pakistan was used by America, create Taliban. They were pumped inside Afghanistan. Even now America is using them for their logistics and everything else, and to kill the same Talibans now. China is using them for their economic purposes. So it is a very, very strategically vulnerable country, and in the bargain they have not been able to stabilize the political system. And this country is on the verge of falling as a nation state. It's the same thing, nation building versus ruining of a nation. This is an example of Pakistan. And read what is there in black. As they say, India has an army, while Pakistan army has a nation. And it is said, the Pakistan army is run by three A's, army, Allah, and America. And out of these three, America is pulling their hand out now. They are left only with two. So if you read more into Pakistani psyche and their systems, they have not been able to build their nation, and their army's contribution, instead of helping out the entire nation to come up, what they have done in order to ensure that they remain in power, they have seen to it all their institutions of governance are, they do not grow at all. And that is the reason that country is totally, a foreign country is going to fall very soon. Now this is a slide, if you look at it, what is the security complexity? In nation building, I said, the army's role is to see to it that we sanitize ourselves from external aggressions. Now if you look at it on the left side, the pointer. Okay. Oh, laser one. Pakistan, you know, it is sponsoring insurgency in J&K. Alright? Because of that, the public order, there is a thing called law and order, which police can control, and there is a thing called breakage of public order, wherein army, central police organizations, Rashtra Rifles, and everybody has to pitch in, and this is what is happening in J&K. And if you look at the right, the yellow one, this is the one. Yeah? I don't see. Go on, sir. Achha. Sorry. Sorry, I don't see. Then just fill
it. This one is red light.
Yeah, voila. Oh, it's too technical for me. Oh. Okay, can you see it? China, anyway, you can read it, tonight is quite a big slide. If you look at China, so they are giving very mixed signal of confrontation and economic cooperation. China wants economic cooperation from India, because India is the largest market in the world as on date. And it is not only market, we have people who can buy stuff, because the way our economy is increasing. Okay, so on one side they want cooperation, on the other side they are indulging in confrontation. You must have heard that Doklam and other things. Basically, their philosophy is coercive diplomacy. That means keep India under check, so that India should not become a regional power and India should not become a global power. And Indian economy should not rise beyond that. So it is a very, very vicious cycle. And if you look at this park, they have got anti-India sign. They have claims over J&K because it is Muslim majority, so it's a claim. Wherein Maharaja Hari Singh, he had signed the instrument of accession. It's a very much legal instrument. There's a controlled irrationality in Pakistan and also in China. What they do, you really do not know what they're doing. And ever since they become nuclear power, the Pakistan is utilizing that nuclear deterrence in order to create problem in India. You must have heard this Pathankot attack, Uri attack and all. Why this such a small country is doing it? It is on the background and the backing of their nuclear power. Because since their nuclear power, they think that India will not attack them or do not pick up military confrontation from them. Besides that, the extra regional powers in our area, if you look at it, in Afghanistan, US is sitting, NATO countries are sitting there, and in Pakistan, China is sitting there. So, all these things, when you look at it, and what you see, the red corridor is the next light area, that the internal security problem, and there is the economic disparity in our country, India and Bharat divide, religious subversion is there, vote bank politics is there, and there is the governance deficit. So, these are security problems that armed forces have to take care of alongside all other institutions of governance in our country. It is not standalone. In our country, there is synergy between all the departments of the government and the armed forces, unlike Pakistan. Now let us go back into history again. Decade of military conflicts, threat to sovereignty of nation, a case of strategic rebound. We started off in 1962. That was a debacle for us. We were not prepared. On one side, Chinese, they used to say Hindi, Chini, bye bye. And we thought, actually, they are our friends. But on the quiet, they were preparing to attack us, to exert their political will. So that was one setback that we have. So it was a wake up call and a game changer for the national security paradigm. So it was a blessing in disguise that they came, and because of that we took lessons, and thereafter the armed forces, they started gradually building up their strength. 3 years thereafter, the transition of army structures and process to enhance the professional quotient to handle the temporary security, contemporary security challenges. In 1965, Indo-Pak War, beginning of national confidence and consolidation of security mechanisms. After 62 debacle, 1965 proved that Indian armed forces, they have come up of age, and that's the time we had whatever problem Pakistan was trying to create, we had stopped that, and we had captured Hajipir Pass, and there was a one armored division of there, they came to Asal Utta, and we stopped that division, and entire division, their troops, they left their tank, pattern tanks, and they went away. And in Asal Utta, long time back, means you people are very young, your dads, when they were young, they must have heard, we created a pattern nagar. So we had given a very solid punch to Pakistan, and that's where our prestige started coming up. And when we come to 1971, that was a day of reckoning for Indian Armed Forces, all three branches, a decisive military victory, boasting the national prestige and strategic presence.